Good morning. My name's Harry, Clean Harry. My job in the church is to be an enforcer of the law, to make a gauntlet for any high plains drifter, to make a sudden impact on anyone walking a tightrope. I'm so good, I want to take the bad and the ugly and hang them high, and to oppose sin every which way I can and every which way but loose. I got a question for you. I got a 44-inch thick King James Bible to hit you over the head with. So here's my question for you. Do you feel blessed, punk? Well, do ya? So go ahead, come to church, make my Sunday. Ladies and gentlemen, let's not be like Clean Harry. I make that point because I think in some ways, all of us at one time or another have had a little bit, he's extreme. We've all had a little bit of Clean Harry in us. Can we go straight to the next slide there, Miss Clara and Kate? Thank you very much. Very simple point, the first point, and it's very simple, but it ties into some big questions we want to ask today. Okay, so point one, our own goodness doesn't cut it. That's basic, that's Christianity 101. That's, I'll read it in the easy English version. All people have done wrong things. Nobody can be good and great as God wanted them to be, but because God is very kind, he accepts us all right with himself. That is God's gift to us. Jesus Christ has paid for our sins so that we have become free. Wonderful message. But outside the walls of the church, here in Dunfermline, out in the big wide world, most people don't get this very simple concept. If you've been in church a while or even a short time, this becomes the ABCs of Christianity. But outside the walls, I remember, do you remember what your thinking was way back when? I remember, even as a 14-year-old, thought I had it all figured out as a 14-year-old. And I remembered there was this 16-year-old girl who was a Christian. And I'd argue with her, and I'd argue, and I was skeptical. And I thought I knew what I was talking about, and I would say to her, you know, I think it's like this. I think if your good outweighs your bad, surely you'll get into heaven because it's just, he grades on the curve. That's what I thought. And this girl turned to me and she said something that offended me. She offended my pride. She said, she quoted a scripture. I didn't understand the scripture. It was a big Christian words. She said, Marco, your own righteousness is as filthy rags. Now, I didn't understand what righteousness meant. It means right standing with God. You're saying I'm not good enough? You're not saying I'm not good enough on my own? And that was the struggle. Let me just very quickly kind of explain the gospel, that even a way that kids can understand. Kids, are you paying attention? Who are the kids? Okay. Let's say your dad is the judge in the courtroom. Where's the wig type thing? And let's say you've done something wrong. Now, your dad's a judge. He has to be fair. He has to be fair to everyone because he's the judge. And so you go in before, you know, you've done it wrong. You've done something serious enough to be taken before the judge. You've committed a crime. And you go before your dad, the judge. And he has to be fair to everyone, so he bangs down the gavel and he says, son or daughter, you're guilty of this crime. And the fine is, say, something like a 10,000 pounds. That's what it costs, your fine costs. You're gonna have to pay for that. And you go, oh no, but dad, I can't pay for that. I don't have that kind of money. But because he's your dad and he loves you, he takes off the wig, he comes out from behind the bench, takes out his wallet, and pays the fine. Isn't that wonderful? And God is like that. God our Father loves us so much. As a judge, as our judge looking at our lives, and we all will stand before him and give an account of our lives, he says, you're guilty of this, you're guilty of that, you're guilty of this. But then, in a way, he does come out from behind the bench. He sends his own son, Jesus, down. And it's not like he took out his wallet and paid money. He bought our lives back with the precious blood of Jesus. We are expensive. You are not worthless. If you think, I'm worthless, I'm not. You know what you cost? You cost the precious blood of Jesus. That's more than all the gold and silver. You are expensive. You mean something. You are loved. God did this for you. And that is, now I want you to put a pin in this whole idea, because this is going to help us answer some big questions I want to ask about things. Now, I want to take you back to, in fact, get to the next slide there, Claire. I want to take you back to the 1970s when I did become a Christian. 3 years after that talk with that girl, when I turned 17, I moved to Ventura, California, because my grandparents were down there. And the first thing my grandmother, she said, she says, Mark, I want to come to church. I think I've told this story. She says, no, I said, no way, Grandma, but they're going to have steak dinner at the church. I've told that story. Well, I did become a Christian at that church in the 1970s. I want to take you back to what it was like in the 1970s. And there just happens to be a film that's out. And I show you the trailer of this film because I want to take you back to that era and what we were thinking about 40, 50 odd years ago, back in that time, back in California, because it affected the whole world, even here in Scotland, even the songs we sing here in the church today. What happened back then had a big effect today. Play that clip, 2 minutes, and thank you very much.
Hey, Square.
I am not a square.
I think we should invite Greg this weekend.
What's this weekend?
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
What they need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
This house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching.
Slow down, man, slow down.
Just in all the wrong places. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them in, I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet.
They need our help. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here.
That was awesome.
Now that door is open any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door works both ways.
All right, Pastor, let's begin.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
The thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
You're gonna need a bigger church.
Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope and it's spreading.
This is your home, and I want you to tell all your friends about it.
Film, highly recommended. I went to see it in Falkirk, Abby and myself, and the young man I often bring to church with me, who Abby and I are discipling, a guy named Hamish. I hope you've met him. But we saw that, and it's available on things like Amazon Prime and stuff like that. So I highly recommend that. But what a time, what an era. Next slide, please. This is what was everyone was thinking about back in the 1970s. This became a huge bestseller at that time. the late great planet Earth. Stuff about the end times, about Bible prophecy. Everyone was talking about it back then. And everyone was going, and the kind of, some people taught about these things in a kind of a fair, even-handed, right way. And some people were scary. In fact, you can go to the internet today. I'm interested in the end times. You put on YouTube and you get these scary headlines that go, But you know what, folks? The book of Revelation is meant to be a blessing. In fact, there's a promise in the book of Revelation that says if we read this book, we will be blessed. In fact, even the young kids here today can understand the plot of the book of Revelation. We can. Because they all have seen The Lion King. Now, if you remember the end of The Lion King, it's very much like the plot of the book of Revelation. You remember what happens? Uncle Scar, the bad lion, takes over the Pride Lands. Remember that? And it becomes a wasteland, it becomes a desert. But then the rightful king returns. And there's a bit of a war with the Uncle Scar and the hyenas that follow him. And then the war is won, and the king, the rightful king, takes his place. And then it's back, the circle of life, you say? But well, a circle is used to represent eternity. Where in the circle does it begin? Where does it end? The circle of eternity. Now, you can only take that analogy so far, because otherwise you'd have Timon and Pumbaa as the two witnesses in the book of Revelation. Should I go there? I can see what's happening. Uncle Scar has taken over. Now I can do signs and wonders. I can even say to the sky, you must shut. And my name is Pumbaa. I can make fire come out. Pumbaa, not in front of the kids. Hakuna Matata. It means no worries. Jesus is coming back soon. He's got it under control. He wants to save your soul. Hakuna Matata. Ladies and gentlemen, Timon and Pumbaa appearing as the two witnesses in the book of Revelation. Only at the Vine Church. Well, let's get okay. Yeah, so looking at the subject, and it's been handled right, it's been handled wrong. Get to the next slide, please. Thank you. A lot of people end up like Chicken Little, running around. The sky is falling, and being all afraid. We're not. I'm gonna steal a quote from Mr. John Stephen over there, who told me this, and he says. He says, these things are not meant to scare you. They're meant to prepare you. It's like when God says to Noah, Noah, build an ark. That's not meant to scare Noah. That's to prepare Noah. And because God is the weatherman, he's in control. He knows what's going to happen. And he's getting us ready. And he's got to, every time you hear a story about what's going to happen, Jesus, and when he talked about these things, always brings it back to, and now you, occupy your space, do what you're supposed to do, get busy, because there are souls to save. Let's go to the next slide there. Oh, yes. I want to read from First John 1:18. John is the apostle that coined the phrase Antichrist. Yeah, every writer in the Bible had different names for this guy, but John, in 1 John and in his letter 2 John, coins the name Antichrist. Now, when he writes the book of Revelation, he uses a completely different name. He uses the name Beast there, but the Apostle Paul calls him the son of perdition, the man of lawlessness. Other writers, Daniel said the prince that will come. All these writers had different names for this guy. 1 John, dear children, this is the last hour. Now, the last hour? That was written 2,000 years ago. This is a long hour, folks. Now, I'm glad I'm very glad God's timing is different than our timing. I'm glad God's idea of soon is different than our idea of soon. I'm glad, now back in the 1970s, we were all saying, Maranatha, Jesus, come back quickly, we want you here now. I'm glad God didn't come back in the 1970s. Why? Because some of these children would not have been born. Some of you would have not have come to faith yet. He was waiting for, yeah, Johnny Mill in the back is saying he wouldn't have been around. Our idea of the last hour and his idea, he's making that hour wait as long as it can until, metaphorically speaking, the last two animals get on the ark, so to say. Which probably zebras if it was in alphabetical order. But he's waiting for you, and he's waiting for more to come into the kingdom of God before he shuts the door. He's waiting for that time, and that's merciful. And so we look at this guy, and let's see, as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming. Next slide, please. Even now, many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour. There have been, so to say, many mini-me's, many little antichrists who have come. But one day, I know that there's an idea that this guy appeared in as Emperor Nero in the year 70, right at the first century. And there's that opinion that the book of Revelation was fulfilled in the year 70. That's a minority view, that's a view. And it's okay if you have that view, you still can go to heaven, that's not a problem. And the majority of the church, those who study these things, believe that this guy is yet to still be revealed. In fact, one day, Wendy, he'll get on the world stage. And he'll say, "Hello, world. I am the anti." I don't even like to say his last name. Ladies and gentlemen, I am the beast that came out of the sea and grabbed all the towels before all the German tourists. I'm bad. I'm really, really bad. I am the son of perdition, and that was just her maiden name. As you can imagine, she had many Asbos in our neighborhood. Now, I would not be complete with all the mini-me's that came before me. Nimrod was a mini-me. Goliath was a tall mini-me. Antiochus Epiphanes was a mini-me. Alexander the Great was a mini-me. Napoleon was a mini-me. Stalin was a mini-me. Hitler was a mini-me. And they all round up to me. I am the beast of Babylon, of Persia, of Greece, of Rome 1 and Rome number 2. I am all those beasts wrapped up into one. Now, And by the way, Stephen, help me here. I go to Stephen's health group, and this costume is way too tight. You know, this is like, whoa. I need work, buddy. Need work. I went to the gym. I promise. I did go to the gym. Okay. when this subject is tackled, the Antichrist, most of the time. And the way I've seen it done on YouTube and the way I've seen it done in teaching is everyone is asking, who? Who is it? 40 years ago in the 1970s, we were asking, who is it? Who is this guy? When are these things going to happen? And but the question that not a lot of people address is why? Why, if God is in control, and he's so good, why does he allow these things to happen? Why does he allow a serpent in the garden? Surely God knew that the serpent was there, and it didn't escape his attention. Why did God allow these mini-me's that have come in the past, these mini antichrists to come? Why is this guy going to be allowed his time on the world stage? Why? Why there's that mysterious scripture, the end of Revelation, where Satan is bound for 1,000 years, but then he's let out again. And I'm going, why? Now, I want to try to answer some of those questions. I need to tell a very sad story about my life as an 11-year-old. Go ahead to next clip, please. Thank you. Oh, Valentine's Day, America. Okay, I'm 11 years old. I've moved to a brand new school. I didn't have any friends. And I was having trouble making friends. Now, America does a weird thing at Valentine's Day when for the primary kids, okay? They have all the kids give each other Valentines. And so your craft section, you make your own heart-shaped box, you tape it on the wall, and everyone goes out and gives everyone else, boys and girls, a Valentine, like, be my friend, a cartoon giraffe, be my friend, okay? So I go to the store, I gather enough Valentines for all my friends, or no friends, but I gather for all my classmates, and come to school on Valentine's Day, go around, and I put the Valentines in everybody's box, okay? And then it comes to my box, and there was no Valentines. And I cried, and it hurt me. It hurt me bad. And I said to the teacher, wow, thinking about it, they didn't give me any Valentines. And so the teacher goes up to these two girls, give Marco a Valentine. So these two girls reluctantly, grudgingly, come up and give me a Valentine. They were forced to love me. Part of the big philosophical question we're looking at, this big why question, has to do with what I've just talked about. I'll try to... Ladies and gentlemen, for there to be real love, for there to be real love that's not robotic, that, you know, a computer won't love you. You can program a computer all day long. You can even program a computer to say, I love you. But the computer doesn't love. If you can fault God for anything, if you can say, God, this is where you blew it, this is where you did it wrong, you can say, he gave us a free will. For there to be real obedience, there needs to be the opportunity for disobedience. For there to be real love, there has to be the opportunity for rejection. Jesus was a man of sorrows, familiar with rejection. Let me go to an early story in the Bible that has nothing to do with the Antichrist and everything to do with why. The Antichrist. 1 Samuel chapter 8. I won't read the whole story, but I'll just summarize it. Samuel the prophet says that the people have come to him and they say, Samuel, we don't want you anymore as a judge. We don't want your kids. We don't want you. We want a king like every other nation has. And Samuel's upset about this. And he goes to God, and he says, God, the people don't want me as their judge anymore. And the Lord says to Samuel, they've not rejected you, they've rejected me. So tell them this is what they will have. They want a king? Give them a king. And this is what the king's going to do. He's going to abuse them. He's going to tax them. He's going to take their children into service. He's going to do all these terrible things. And the people hear all this from Samuel, and they say, we want a king. And that is partly the reason why that is the answer to this big question, why? Why? The world has rejected Christ as king, for those who have rejected him as king. And so you don't want Christ as king? Get a load of the other guy. This is the answer to what you want. You want your own way? You want this? This is why he is coming. Now, what can we do about this? Church, can we pray him away? Can we stop him from coming? No. No more than Noah could stop the rain from coming. But like Noah, you can book your place on the ark. Okay? Now, I want to conclude with a song. In fact, hold on just one second here. I have to change out of this tight outfit. Give me one second here. Hold on. You with me, okay? You're paying attention? Help me. Can I get some help here? I need some. Thank you. Somebody who's tall. Give Aaron a hand. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Thankfully, there's no burlesque music. I would be very, very. See? Now, this is what I want to bring us back to right here, Revelation 17:4. Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, if we don't want, if we've rejected Christ as King, that's a very sad place to be. This may be the song that you sing at the end of the day. So you do know that there's two courts at the end of the day. There's a good court, and there's a court you don't want to be at the end of the day. At the end of time, at the end of it, when it all comes down to it, when the book is closed, as C.S. Lewis said, when the author walks on stage, the play is over. In fact, you can put on the last slide there, Clara. And we can also put on a song. I'm going to sing a song for you. This is a song about a guy who's, he's at the other court that you don't want to be at. Okay? Because, we got that slide there. Oh, a little bit down. No, that's okay. Now, the end is near. There's a great white throne. The books are open. And everyone will hear the things I did. The words I've spoken. I lived life like a fool. Ran from my maker and didn't pray. Oh, and sin much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a lot, far too many to mention, but you'll hear it all anyway at this judgment seat convention. I believe the lies, I laughed off truth. Jesus, I didn't give him the time of day. Oh, and sin much more than this. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got if he doesn't have Jesus? He doesn't have a lot. Oh, I'm a self-made man, so full of pride. My number was up, and then I died. Let the record show, I sold my soul and did it my way. Guys, there are some of us here today that need to get our the kingship sorted. Are we going to be the king? Are we going to do it our way? Or are we going to make Jesus the king of our lives? Some of you have made Jesus king, but you're still wrestling with some areas that need to be turned away from. You need to give him control of your lives. Jesus is king. He's in control. And for those of us who've been in the church a long time and are studying these things about the end times and the book of Revelation and stuff like that, here's the message for you. Get busy. There are souls to bring in. There are people to pray for. There are things to do that we need to get done, because God's going to hold off that hour. God's going to stretch that hour out because he's waiting for the final people to get in. And we're just like in the 1970s, we're to occupy. We're to keep our lamps lit. We're to keep going. Can we bow our heads and pray? Father God, thank you for the Vine Church. And I pray, dear God, that everyone here would know that you are in control. There's nothing to be afraid of. We're to be prepared, but not scared. Dear Lord, I pray, dear God, that you'd help us to get busy. You'd help us to pray in souls. You'd help us to reach out to souls. You'd help us to bring in people into the kingdom before the door shuts. Dear Lord. And Lord, help us to, for those here who have not given their lives completely to you, I pray, dear God, that today they would bow their knee to King Jesus, that they would surrender in Jesus' precious name. I'm going to hand it back over to Pastor Aaron, but folks, thank you very much. My son Michael and I will be doing a more in-depth discussion on this whole topic, as we did with Christmas headcrackers and purpose of porpoise skin and things like that. And so there's a bigger study on all this that will be appearing on YouTube and the Vine Net and things like that. But I'm going to hand it over back to Pastor Aaron. Thank you, church. God bless you.